Okay, hi. In this video, I'm going to go over a quick review of some concepts from calculus. So this is from my introduction to computational science course, mainly. So my main goal of this is you know, I want to review or go over just some of the basic concepts that would be really useful to know before you do the rest of this course, okay? So, you know, if you've never taken calculus before, you might be okay. I assume you do know how to do things like some basic algebra, so manipulate equations algebraically. And hopefully you've done some geometry where you've, like, graphed functions, like on an XY axis, that type of thing. If you have that, you really should have enough to be able to grasp what you need, the important concepts of calculus that you need for this class in order to do numerical methods, okay? So in particular, okay, today we're going to go over functions and graphs a little bit, so kind of starting back from that point, from sort of geometry and what a function is. But then we're going to look at the concept of a derivative, okay? So, you know, this is what you would learn in a calculus course, but then you learn a lot of other stuff. And you know, I want you to understand what the basic idea of a derivative is, okay? Then from there, we'll look at some applications, so why are derivatives useful, just some examples. We've already actually done a little bit of that in this course already, even though we haven't talked about derivatives, what they are yet. And then we'll look at integrals and integration, okay? So derivatives, integration is related to derivatives. It's really the reverse process or the antiderivative, okay? So, all right. So let's... I'm mostly in the lecture notebook I'm using. I have some other additional things that would be good to check out, both some kind of online courses with videos, lectures, and things, and quite a few textbooks. Okay, so if you want to go deeper onto one of these, I suggest you look at those. I did find most useful just for this kind of review. I am using a lot of examples from this basic calculus refresher from UW-Madison, so now I'll actually maybe pull that back up for a few things I actually don't quite have in the lecture notebook yet. Okay. All right, so we'll start with functions and graphs. So we've been using functions in this class both in the mathematical sense and in the programming sense already, okay? So I hope you've got a grasp on the basics of what we mean by that, all right? So the simplest idea of a function is a function of a single independent variable. So normally we say something like y, which is our dependent variable, is a function of x, which is the independent variable, okay? So an important thing to understand about the functions that we're talking about here is that it's a mapping, and it's a one-to-one mapping, okay? So these kinds of functions, for every value of x, there's a unique value of y it maps to, okay? So different values of x could and often do map to the same value of y. That's fine. But for each one of these, but every x maps just to one value of y is what I'm trying to say, right? So when you put in an x, you get a y, all right? So what do we mean by function? Well, the simplest function we can imagine is a constant function. So, for example, y equals 3, okay? So, I mean... How is this a function in the sense that y depends on x? Well, it doesn't. I mean, you know, it's not really this in terms of y depending on a function of x. Although, you can look at it like this, that y equals 0 times x plus 3, okay? And why we use this form, I'll talk about in a bit here. So, in this case, you can also think of it as it depends on x, but always x is just multiplied by 0. Okay, so no matter what the value of x is, it doesn't change what the value of y is for this mapping. So this is a constant function. We could graph this function. So again, I hope you've done something like this before. So normally when you graph a function, what you're doing is you want to visualize over some range. So I mean, you can't graph the whole, you know, so x can range from negative infinity to positive infinity. So you'll never be able to see the whole function. But you can concentrate on a particular range of values, a particular interval, and see what the function looks like on that range. So for a constant function like this, like y equals 3 or y equals 0x times 3, it's not very interesting, of course. It just makes a straight horizontal line, right? So no matter what the value of x is, y is 3, right? Another thing I'll just mention here real quickly. So one thing that Python allows you to do nicely, since Python supports vectorized operations using NumPy, So if x is a scalar, if we just pass in one value, we'll get its mapping to the corresponding value of y. It's f of x, right? But if we pass in a range of values like this, it'll map all of the values. So in this case, we're passing a bunch of values in the range from negative 3 to 3, and it returns the mapping, which is y is 3 for all these cases. So interesting, but... But the point is that this makes it very easy, you know, when you have like a mathematical idea of a function and representation that's used normally in mathematics, we can pretty almost directly kind of write code in Python that directly implements that, right? All right, let's look at something more interesting. So another thing that I hope that maybe you did do at some point in the past in you know, high school or something, geometry. Let's talk about lines and equations of lines, okay? So, let's talk about the slope of the line and the slope-intercept equation, all right? So, the slope of a line is simply the ratio of the change in y written delta y. So, this triangle is a Greek delta. So, whenever I see this, I just call that the delta y or the change in y. Actually, when I read this, I usually read it in English written as the change in y... to the change in x. Delta x is the change in x, okay? So that ratio defines the slope, all right? So what do we mean by that? So for this constant function, the line has a slope of 0 because, for example, for a change in x of 1, y changes, has 0 change, okay? So it's always 0. No matter how much x changes on the bottom here, y never changes. So the delta y, change of y, is always 0. So the slope is always 0 for this line, okay? So here's just a little bit more of a complicated function, y equals 2x, okay? Now the line is no longer flat. So if you graph this function, it looks like this on the graph. So when x is 0, y is 0, of course. But when x is 2, y is 4. And when x is negative 2, y is negative 4. So that defines a line, right? Now, this line has a slope, by our definition of a slope, of 2, right? Because, for example, when x changes from 0 to 1, so x delta x is 1, changing from 0 to 1, y changes from 0 to 2. So the ratio is the change in y is 2 divided by the change in x is 1, right? So you get a slope of 2. And in fact, everywhere on this line, the slope is always 2, okay? So, you know, if you start at negative 2 and you change if you start at negative 3 and you change by 3, x goes from negative 3 to 0, and y goes from negative 6 to 0. So that's negative 6 divided by negative 3, so also a slope of 2, right? So everywhere along this line, this equation for a line, y equals 2x, we have a slope of 2, right? Of course, you can easily change the slope. So if I say y equals 4x, now the line will kind of look the same because it changed the aspect ratio of my axes, but the slope has now changed from 2 to 4 for this line. So when I go from x goes from 0 to 1, y has gone from 0 to 4, okay? So that's a ratio of 4 to 1, or a slope of 4. And you can have negative slopes. So I could have had y equals negative 2x. So notice on the previous line, y equals 2x, this is what's known as a positive slope. So for a positive slope, anytime x increases, y increases. So you get a line that goes up from left to right, right? So if you have negative slopes, like negative 2, this is negative, so anytime x increases, like from 0 to 1, y is decreasing. Y is decreasing by 2, so you get your ratio is negative. Change in y is negative 2 to a change in x of 1, so slope of negative 2, right? all right, so let's add another term to the equation. So let's look at what the equation y equals 2x plus 3 looks like. So, whoops, this is the equation of our line, y equals 2x plus 3. So here, actually this line still has the same slope of 2. So for example, when y is 0, or when x is 0, y is 3, because you can see when you plug in 0 here, you get y of 3. And then when x changes to 1, y is 5. So the change in y is 2, it goes from 3 to 5, divided by the change in x goes from 0 to 1, so 1. So it's still 2, right? So again, the slope of this line is 2. It's just that we've shifted it up. So now instead of intercept, well, this is called the intercept. So the number times x is the slope, m, and what we're adding in here is called the intercept term, and this is the slope-intercept form of an equation of a line here. So by adding in an intercept of 3, then the intercept mean is the location that when x is 0, when x changes from negative to positive, what the value of y is. So that'll just make y intercept at x is 0, so y will be 3 when x is 0. If I had my equation right, there we are. So didn't mean to confuse there. So that's the equation actually. So when x is 0, y is 3, right? And yeah, by changing that intercept term, you're just you're not changing the slope of the line. You're just shifting the line up and down. So I could have an intercept of negative 5. So now when x is 0, y crosses the line crosses the y axis at y is negative 5, all right? All right, back to our original equation. So that's the equation of lines. This is the basic form, all right? So this form of a line, this equation of a line, has several advantages. So it allows you to directly see what the slope is. So if you put it into this form, the slope slope-intercept form, you'll know that if you need to know the slope of the line at any point, it's that. It's the value m that you're multiplying x by. And if you want to know where the line crosses the y-axis, it'll be at that location, the intercept part. All right. So kind of to summarize, and at this point, there's a couple of things that you ought to understand, right? Or you ought to be able to figure out for yourself, right? So we talked about a couple of these. The line, for one thing, a line always has a constant slope. So everywhere for a line, its slope is always 2 in this case, right? Or its slope is always what the slope term is for your equation. So for this line, my slope is always 5. So when I change from 0 to 1, y changes from 3 to 8, basically, right? Slope of 5. So I already said this, the slope-intercept equation of a line allows you to directly see the slope. So here the slope is 5, and also to just directly determine the intercept location, where it crosses the y-axis, right? Where the line crosses that axis. And I mentioned positive and negative slope. So a positive slope describes a line that when x gets bigger, y gets bigger. So it goes from left to it goes up from left to right. And a negative slope describes a line that when x gets bigger, y gets smaller. So it goes down from left to right. And the slope of 0 is a constant function. Okay, so it defines a flat line. And you can't really have an infinite slope because an infinite slope would correspond to even a 0 change in x, y changes about infinitely large, right? It changes to infinity, right? So you can't really have that. But you can have something with a really big slope, like 1 million, for example. So now when x changes 1, y changed to a million, basically. Here, well, 1,000,003 is what it's at right here since 3 is our intercept term. So. All right, so those are the basic things that you need to know, right? And you have to be clear what a slope means in terms of a line, right? Especially this idea that the slope of a line is always the same. So it has one slope everywhere. So lines are relatively simple functions of a single variable. We can have much more complex functions, okay? So here's a couple. Even restricting ourselves still to just a single, a function of a single independent variable x, right? So here's some others. Y equals x squared, or y equals 2/3 x cubed minus 5x squared, or y equals 2 to the x, okay? So these are all examples. The first two, actually the first three, are examples of polynomial functions. So any time y, the terms of x are just powers like 1, 2, 3, or even like negative 1, or even fractional powers, those are known as polynomials, okay? So, and x things where the highest term is an x squared have a special name. Those are called quadratic, although I'm not certain why. It sounds like it ought to be like a to the fourth power quad, but anyway, quadratic actually means functions with a square. So you can have a function like x squared plus 2x plus 1 is also a quadratic. So you can have lower order terms here. Oops, I forgot. Right, so this is still a quadratic function, even though it's got a linear term and a constant term. And this, in turn, things with the power of 3 are called cubic. And then, yeah, we usually just call it fourth power, fifth power, above that. Right, but these are all examples of polynomials. So they're additions and subtractions of various powers of x, basically. Okay, you can have other kinds of functions, like you can have trigonometric functions in there. So functions of sine of x and cosine of x and things like that, and logarithms and things like that make more complex functions. So. The only one that's kind of really different is this one. So this is not a polynomial function. This is an exponential function. So anytime x appears as an exponent, like 2 to the x or 2 to the 3 times 3x or something like that, you've got an exponential function, 10 to the x, right? Okay, anyway, so we can graph these functions just like we did for the line. Okay, these represent a unique mapping. So for every single value of x, there's one value of y it maps to. Different values of x could map to the same value of y, so that couldn't happen for a line, but here's an example of what I meant by that. So for in fact, negative 4 maps to 16 for our quadratic function, and 4 maps to 16. So both of those values actually map to the same dependent value of y, right? But every value of x has one and only one value of y. There's no two different locations for the function here, all right? So anyway, there's our quadratic function, right? Makes a nice, this is all your quadratic functions make parabolas, right? Even if you add in some lower order kind of thing, you still get kind of parabolas, so. And this is a cubic function, so this is a cubic polynomial with x cubed as the highest power. So they usually have some wiggles in them, so if we had graphed this a little bit bigger, you would have seen it going back up as well, I think. So this makes the range from negative 5 to 10, so yeah, you'll see something like that, an up and a down for a cubic. If you have a power of 4 in there, you'll get two kind of wiggles and so on, right? So those are our basic. Let me change this back to a straightforward, just x squared, y equals x squared here. Let's move on to the concept of a derivative here. Right, so these higher order polynomials, functions, and any complex function, in fact, they no longer have a constant slope, right? So the slope is changing. I mean, and it's most obvious for this, for example. I mean, obviously the slope, if we can figure out how to measure it, it looks negative here. So when x is increasing, y is decreasing. So it's kind of negative. It's bigger negative up here, and it starts getting smaller and smaller until you get right here. So when x is zero, y is zero, but it changes from going down to going back up. Right. This is an example of the minima, a minima of a function right here. All right. So at the minima and the maxima, the slope is zero. So if you measured it right at zero here, it would be essentially zero. The slope is kind of essentially zero. And then the slope becomes positive over here. Right. So when x is increasing, y is again increasing. It becomes bigger and bigger. The slope becomes larger and larger as you go further to the right here. So right. So, but how would we measure the slope? So, for one, you should realize it's not constant, so it's not the same. There are different slopes here. I mean, there's definitely some over here where it's kind of negative, zero here, some over here where it's positive. So it's changing. So I mean, you know, we can use the equation for a line to approximate the slope, right? So go back to our definition for the slope. M is just the ratio of the change of y over the change of x. So if I want to know the slope of the line of my quadratic equation at the point 2, I can measure, and that's what we do in this figure here. Okay, so I'll skip over the code, leave it kind of as an exercise for you to see how I drew this. But here, so if I want to know the slope of my equation right here, I could say make a delta x of 3. So when x changes from 2 to 5, y changes from 4 to 25, okay? So for a delta x of 3, there's a delta y of 21. 21 divided by 3 gives you 7. So actually the slope of this line, this is actually a secant line from that point to that point. So that defines a line between those two points. And that line actually has a slope of 7, all right? Now, if we only change delta x, if we change x by 2, x goes from 2 to 4, so delta x is 2, and y goes from 4 to 16, so 12. So we get 12 divided by 2, or we get 6. So this line has a slope of 6. There. And if we just change delta x by 1, y goes from 4 to 9, so we have 5. 5 divided by 1 is 5. So the slope of this line with the delta x of 1, the secant line, is 5, right? Now, intuitively, you know, we won't prove it or anything, but you can kind of see, you can kind of just should be able to see yourself, if you keep doing this, if you keep getting smaller and smaller, the line eventually is going to be the line that's actually the tangent to my curve right at the point 2, right? So if delta x, if I make it 0.5, my slope is going to get smaller again. So if I make my delta x of 0.5 here, so I go from 2 to 2.5, you won't be able to see it very well in there, but the slope is going to be less than 5 here, so y changes by 2.5, and x changes, I didn't change this here, that's why. There we go, so it goes down to 4.5, okay? And if we go further, say like 2.1, so as we approach 2, so as delta x gets smaller and smaller, it's approaching 0. So now for a delta of 0.1, we get 4.0999. If you kept doing that, you would find that the slope gets closer and closer to 4. So as delta x gets smaller and smaller, it becomes closer and closer to 4, right? So the argument is that if you actually reach a delta x of 0, you'll actually end up having this tangent line, and the slope will be exactly 4 for my function. For this quadratic function y equals x squared at the point 2 here, all right? So we can do this. There's a formal notation known as the limit that describes that does exactly what I was just describing here. In the limit, as delta x approaches 0, so as the delta x gets smaller and smaller, if you measure the slope of those lines for delta x, you know, starting out big but getting smaller and smaller, you'll see that it gets closer and closer to some value, right? So 2 in this case, right? And we can write that like this. So here, notice all we did here, delta x is still the same, but here we just replaced delta y by calculating the change in y. So f of x plus delta x minus f of x is actually delta y. That's going to be how much y changes at the point between the point from x to the point delta x. All right. So you should make certain you understand what I said there, kind of how that happened, why we have that form that change in notation here. The other thing that you should notice though is that the slope is going to be different. So this is what's known as the instantaneous slope or the instantaneous rate of change. So at the point 2, the slope is 4, right? But you won't get the same thing if you measure the slope at 1. It's actually less, and even more obviously, you won't get the same thing if you measure it at 0 here, right? As you approach trying to measure the slope at 0, the tangent line is going to get flatter and flatter until you actually get a line with a slope of 0, right, at this point. The slope of the line at 1 is actually 2, not 4, okay? So this idea of a couple of concepts there, make certain you understand. I mean, one, for most complex functions, the slope is not the same. Everywhere on the curve, the slope is slightly different. And this is how you can measure with this idea of taking a limit. So if you measure smaller delta x, you'll approach some number, and that's what the true slope is at that instantaneous point, so the instantaneous rate of change. And that instantaneous rate of change, that is basically the concept of the derivative. Another name for the instantaneous rate of change is the derivative. All right. So what we just described is that concept. And it has a special notation. Actually, it has multiple notations. So you'll see the concept of the derivative written in many different notations. So dy, dx. So that represents, this represents the slope of the dependent variable y at some instantaneously at some particular point x. All right. So you can write the derivative in other ways, like df of x over dx, right? ddx of your function, whatever your function is. So we're using the quadratic function. Y equals x squared is f of x here. You'll see this prime notation sometimes, f prime. There's in physics you use a dot notation, so you use x with a dot over it to mean the derivative of your independent variable, basically the instantaneous, rate of change. It's the same thing, x dot, okay? So, this is one thing that confuses lots of beginning students or people taking calculus, all these different notations. It's unfortunate, but that's for a couple of reasons. I mean, calculus was invented by multiple people, Newton and Leibniz, not to mention it's been used in so many different areas, lots of areas, physics and chemistry and sciences. All developed their own kind of specialized notation, but they were all doing the same concept, the derivatives. So thus you get these different sorts of things. Okay. So, the next thing here, so I've already said the slope is different, so it's actually 2 at this point. It's actually 1 when x is 1. It's actually 0 when x is 0. It's actually negative 1. It's 4 when x is 2, it's 2 when x is 1. It's actually negative 2 when x is negative 1, right? So the question is it possible to come up with a formula that can be used to determine what the instantaneous slope is, what the derivative is of the function at a given point? So if I want to know what is the derivative of this the quadratic function, y equals x squared, at x is 3, what is it, right? Is there any way? And it turns out there is a way to come up with a formula that specifies the derivative for many types of functions. Okay? But let's see how you go about doing that real quickly. This is not essential that you understand this, but it's actually not too tough to understand how these properties of derivatives were derived. Okay, so let's go back to the definition of the slopes, just the change in y or change in x. Okay, so if we're using f of x as x squared, the change in y is going to be y changes from x to x plus delta x. Okay, if we're changing from by delta x, y changes its value. So when x is x, y is going to be x squared. Okay, and when x is x plus delta x, y is going to be x plus delta x squared. Okay, so that's why we have this notation. And delta x, the change in x is just the change in x, right? However much big of a step you made to go from x, you added on delta x. So it changed. So it's delta x plus delta x minus x. So it's just delta x there, right? So this might look complex, but we're just using, we're just expanding this using algebra. Okay, so if you take this square term and you expand it out, you get x squared plus delta x plus delta x, so plus 2, plus x delta x, so plus 2x delta x, plus delta x squared, then minus the x squared term, okay? So that's all we did on this part. The x squared minus x squared cancels out, and we can factor out the delta x, so we get delta x times 2x plus delta x over delta x, right? And then the delta x's will cancel out here, so that simplifies to 2x plus delta x, all right? But, okay, so here's the tricky part here. So the derivative is actually the instantaneous rate of change when delta x goes to zero. Okay, so when delta x is zero, you're just left with 2x, right? So step back and see what you said. So what we've said is again, this is only specific for this f of x, for the quadratic function, y equals x squared. But for this quadratic function, the slope is going to be always 2x. So you can find the slope at any location on my function by just multiplying 2 times x, right? So that implies that the slope when x is 3 is 6, and when it's 4, it's 8, right? Which makes sense. It's the slope is getting bigger and bigger. When it's negative, so it's negative 1, it's negative 2. When it's negative 3, it's negative 6, right? It's just 2x. All right? So the derivative of y equals x squared is 2x, and that allows you to calculate the slope anywhere on the curve, instantaneous, at any particular point x. That's your derivative, all right? So we can use that. So again, just to show, I think I'll skip over this, leave it as a exercise for you to look at the code, to understand how we plotted these things. So this is just to illustrate. So here, using that concept of the derivative, using the function that we derived for the derivative of our f of x, which is x squared, so the derivative is 2x. So we can use that then to figure out what the slope is going to be, what our derivative is going to be at any point, and draw the tangent line, which is all I'm doing here. So we have a slope of 8 when x is 4, a slope of 0 when x is 0, slope of negative 8 when it's negative 4, and so on, right? But for other functions, so 2x is the derivative only for x squared, okay? So for other functions, though, you can do a similar thing. So if I wanted to find out what the slope is, what the derivative is for the function y equals x cubed, I could have just done that, but it would have just been x plus delta x cubed minus x cubed, and you could have expanded out. If you did that, you would find that the slope for y equals x cubed is 3x squared, okay? So that tells you that at any place on the function y equals x cubed, if you want to find the derivative, you take 3 times x squared, and that gives you the derivative. That gives you the instantaneous slope at that point. The derivative for y equals x to the fourth is actually 4x cubed, okay? So by doing that, by doing that same thing but for x cubed, x to the fourth, people found out, derived this general power rule, okay? So whenever you have a polynomial of the form x raised to some power p, like x cubed, its derivative is going to be p times x raised to the p minus 1. So notice that held for x squared, its derivative was 2 times x raised to the power 1. For x cubed, like I just said, it'll be 3 times x squared. This even works for like a line. So when our line was y equals 2x, by the power rule, its slope is going to be 2 times x raised to the 1 minus 1, or 2 times x raised to the 0, or just 2. So the slope is just 2 everywhere for the line y equals 2x. All right. Likewise, you can do some. It's more complex, but you can find other general rules of derivation for other more complex functions. So for like an exponential function, you can find rules for what the derivative of a logarithm is. You can find rules, and derivative of a natural logarithm is this, right? So, it's beyond the scope of this course. Sometimes in a calculus course, you might look at how some of these are discovered. Sometimes they'll just give these to you, and you kind of memorize them, okay? And then the other thing here, what you often spend a lot of time in a calculus course is you start kind of with these rules of derivation, and then these properties of derivatives. So I didn't have these written down, but things like the derivative of a constant, and the sum and difference rule. So let's just take this one. The sum and difference rule says that if you want to find the derivative of something like a polynomial expression like this, which is a bunch of additions and subtractions of different polynomials, if you just find the derivative of each one individually, that'll be the derivative of all of them. So the derivative of this one is just this, okay? Oh, and I didn't mention, for the power rule, it also works for fractional exponents. So the derivative of x to the 3/2 is just 3/2 times, subtract 1 from that, so 3/2 times x to the 1/2, right? And the other. So like I said, I mean, a lot of time, what you spend a good deal of, like, a calculus 1 or 2 courses, you kind of are given these, and then you have to figure out what the derivative is of more and more complex kinds of functions, right? So if I'm given this function, what's its derivative? I need to apply the chain rule to do it, right? You don't really need to be able to do that, you know, or remember how to do that for this course, because we don't do a lot of things symbolically. We're interested in doing numerical computation, so it's enough that you understand the concept, understand the concept of what the derivative is and kind of what some of its uses are. And you won't really have to. In fact, you know, and lots of times there are many functions that aren't easily, that you can't easily or impossible to find, like the derivative of, in which case you have to use a numerical method, which is part of what this class is about, you know, learning how you can numerically calculate a derivative of a function. So, okay, so what are some applications of derivatives? I already kind of hinted at one, finding minima and maxima. Here's one, but both of these, finding minima and maxima and finding the roots of an equation. When we talk about solving equations, we'll get a little bit more into some examples of these. But here's just one real quickly. So a root of an equation is a value of x such that when you plug in that value, you get 0, okay? So it's the value of x such that f of x is 0. So y ends up being 0. So sometimes it can be tough to find the root, and sometimes it can be very tough or impossible for some complex equations to find it symbolically. But there are well-known numerical methods that allow you to search for it and find it relatively efficiently. And the Newton method or the Newton-Raphson method is one of these. Okay, but anyway, so the root. So for example, for this polynomial, it's not too complex, but it's a cubic. So it has a power of 3 in there, plus a squared and a linear. If you graph this function, you have to maybe do a little bit of searching, but you can find that one place it crosses, so one place where y is 0, where the function is 0, is about right there. So that's somewhere around 2.4, 2.5, maybe 2.45, something like that, right? And you see that. So when x is 2.4 something, y is going to be 0. That's a root. That's what we mean by a root, okay, one of those values, right? So here, the Newton method actually defines a series, like we talked about already in this course, right? So if you take an initial value of x, and if you subtract this expression, which is just the ratio of the value of the function divided by the derivative of the function. So we're using that prime notation here, but the derivative of the function at that location. If you do that and use that as that, if you keep iterating that, so then now you take that as your next value of I and calculate I plus 1. If you do that, that series will converge on a root, okay? So let's first just show that that's true. So let's, if you start off at 2, right here, so x of 0 is 2, and so here's our function, and here's the derivative of our function. So the derivative of this function is 3x squared. I'm using the power rule and the chain, and the sum and differences here. So the derivative of this is just 3x squared minus 42x plus 135. Right? So this is 135x to the 0, 1 times 135x to the 0. And the derivative of a constant just goes away. So it's just 0, basically. So that term goes away. Right? So we end up with this as the derivative. So if you start with x as 2, and then each time you update by subtracting the function at x divided by the derivative of the function at that x to get the next value, you see that it goes from 2 to 2.41, and then the next time is 2.46, and then so on. So after 10 iterations, you can see it's actually going back and forth between these two values, blah, 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 0.45, and blah, 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 0.6. So it's somewhere in between 0.4, 0.6 to the, like, 12th decimal digit here, right? And you can confirm this if you plug that function in back into that value at our ninth iteration back into the function, you get not quite zero, you know. So this is an approximation method. It's not exact, but you know, this is something times 10 to the -14. So it's very close to zero. It's 14 zeros before you get to the first digit, right? And if you use like a 64-bit floating point number with more precision and you iterated more, you can get even closer, as arbitrary close to zero as you needed to for your root, right? So this is a numerical method. The result won't be exactly zero. And it defines a series that approaches the root, you know, approaches the closest root. How does it work? So real quickly, you know, I don't want to get too hung up in the details on this, but let's look at what I just did here in this expression. So we started at 2, and at that point, the function is negative, right? So it's below 0. So the up above here will be a negative number, but the slope is positive, notice. So the derivative is positive. So the result of dividing the negative by a positive is a negative number. So when you subtract that, you actually get an increase. So whatever value, you're subtracting a negative. So you actually end up adding. So that's why you go from 2 to 2.4, right? Now, let's say we had started at like 3 instead of 2. So at this point, the slope is positive, but also the function value is positive well. So both f of x and f prime, the derivative of f at that point, 3, would be both positive. So at that point, 3, you'd be subtracting the value, so you'd go left, okay? So basically, what happens because of that, because of the argument I just did, if you're less than 0 and the slope is positive, you need to increase x to go towards the slope, right? Because you want to follow this gradient, follow the slope up. You know, your root must go in this direction. And if you're above 0 and the slope is positive, that means you need to subtract, you need to go less. You need to make x smaller. And by dividing this and subtracting, you do the right thing based on what the sign is of the function at that point and what the sign is of the derivative, which gives you what your slope is. The same argument could be made. So if I had a function that had a negative slope, you get the same thing, but you go in the correct direction towards the root, depending on whether the function is above or below zero, and whether the slope is and the slope is negative in that case. So in both cases, the slope would be negative. Right. So that's there's more going on. You know, because you're using the derivative, it makes it go slower. Notice this. So for example, the function is going to get closer and closer to zero as you approach the root. So your steps will become smaller and smaller. So that's why it tends to converge rather than kind of diverge, you know. So it'll get, the steps will become smaller and smaller as you approach the root. Okay. So that's an example of root finding. So another common thing that we'll do a little bit of in this class is finding minima and maxima. So again, for the same polynomial, previously I had only graphed it from 2 to 3, but if you extend your range a bit, let's say graph it from 2 to 12, you'll see against a cubic function, so you got two little wiggles. So you see it looks like it has a maximum here, about 3, and a minimum here at 9, actually exactly at 5 and 9. And again, as we already mentioned, you know, we know the maximum or the minimum are going to be occurring when the slope is zero. So basically, finding maximum and minimum, or you want to find the places where the derivative is zero. Okay, so this is different from finding the root. So finding the root is where the function is zero, like right here. Finding maximum and minimum are the places where the slope, the derivative, goes to zero, here and here, right? So, for this particular polynomial, you can actually factor it. So if you divide by 3 and then factor it, you find that this polynomial is actually 3 times x minus 5. So this tells you, if I stick in 5, that'll result in a 0. So that means that the derivative must be 0 here. If I stick in a 9, you'll also result in 0. So you get a 0 here, right? So those are your roots for this, for our derivative expression here, right? But, you know, again, if your derivative was a complex expression, I could use the root finding method that I did before to find the zero, you know, find locations where this is zero. So use a numerical method to, say, start x0 at 4 and then have it find there, But again, you'd be doing it on the derivative expression, not on the function itself, if you wanted to find, you know, your minima and maxima, all right? So this is too well known. The minimum and finding the minimum is very important in many areas of science. So for example, for machine learning, you define what's known as a cost function, and the place where that cost function is minimum gives you the best model that for your machine learning algorithm for many machine learning sorts of modeling tasks, right? So and then there's lots of other applications where you want to find the minimum of some function defined like this, right? So, but those functions can be very complex with many hundreds or thousands or even millions of terms in it. So it's not so straightforward that you can factor it or symbolically find the minimum. So you have to use a numerical method to search and find a place where the gradient, where the derivative goes to zero here. So. All right. So lastly, let's look at what an integral is. Okay, so integrals and derivatives are definitely related. So I already mentioned previously in this class, if you know nothing else, at least if you know the idea that an integral measures the area under a curve, that's probably all. As long as you know that much, understand that much, you probably know enough for this introduction to computational science course. So again, we're going to be looking at numerical methods for integrating functions rather than solving it symbolically and finding an exact solution. But here we're talking about trying to find an exact solution. All right, so here, the definition of an integral, again, I'll go back to some of my source material here, looks something like this. So if we have a function, little f of x, right? And we want to find the area under the curve from like a to x, right? So that's what we want to do. So if we could find a function that determines that area, this would be a good function. So here, a is just an arbitrary starting point. But given what x is, we would like big f of x to return this area. And that's a unique mapping. So this just defines a function. It's a good function, just like we were talking about before. But here, you know, by plugging in x, it would return what this area is, all this blue part, the area underneath my little f of x from a up to x, all right? And if I want to know what the area is at f of x plus delta x, if I want to add a little bit more, you know, I just say f of x plus delta x. So this area is different from just f of x. So over here, the area of the blue plus the area of the green would be the area of the function at x plus delta x that I want my big F to return, all right? So that's just the concept. This function. So if we had this function so we're assuming that somehow we could have this function that does that, okay? It just returns that area. So what can we do with that idea, this big F here, all right? So f of x, let's just say, you know, let fx be a function that returns the area under the graph in that interval from a to x. So then f of x plus delta x, as I already said, would be the area under the graph in the interval from a to x plus delta x. So then the area under the graph from x plus delta x, so the area of just this green part, I could just subtract those two. So you should be able to convince yourself. You take the area of both of these and you subtract this area, you're just left with this green area. So that's all we did here. That's the area under the graph of the interval from x to delta x, okay? But here's where we kind of do the tricky thing. But this is where we get the relationship of this big F to the derivative, all right? So, you should be able to convince yourself, if you look at this green area here, that there has to be some location z between x and x plus delta x that this rectangle here with the dotted line at the top, if you calculated its area, would be exactly equal to the green area here. So you can move z, but somewhere, if you move z, you'll get to a point where this area that's left out is exactly equal to this area that's out of my dotted rectangle here, right? So once you find that z, then, basically, this is equivalent to the green area, which is the area from x under the curve from x to x plus delta x, all right? So the area of this, though, by this argument, is just f of z, because f of z gives you the height to this point, times delta x. So the base from x to x plus delta x is just delta x, and the height is z. So z times f of z gives you that area, right? And that should be equal to this green area here, right? So why is that important? Well, because so we wrote that here. So the area of that other little box that is equal, if we can find that z, is just f of z times delta x. But and rearranging, so we could bring the delta x over here. So why do we do that? So this should look familiar. This is basically the same as the expression we use for the derivative. Okay, so this is the finite difference between x, the function at x plus delta x minus f of x divided by delta x. So this is equivalent to the derivative that we were using before. So this is actually the derivative of the big function f. All right. Here, if we took it to the limit. So, but if delta x goes to zero, so here, back to this, if this gets smaller and smaller, if delta x goes to zero, then z has to be x, okay? So if delta x was zero, x and x plus delta x are the same, so z must be the same as x. So in the limit, as this goes to zero, this just becomes f of z, so the area just becomes the height. All right, so you know, if you follow that, so the trick then is that since this is another expression for the derivative, what we've said is that the derivative of this big function f of x equals this function that we're trying to find the area under the curve here. Okay, right? Now we know how to take the derivative of a function. So if we could find the function such that its derivative equals this function we want to find the area under, that would give us a way to calculate this area in a symbolic manner. Okay, and finding that is just kind of the reverse. So we looked at finding the derivative of a function. So we kind of want to do the inverse of that. So we want to find the function such that its derivative is the function we want to get to. That's known as the antiderivative, okay? And the antiderivative is really just the integral. The antiderivative gives us the integral, and then I'll show you in a second, then we can use that antiderivative to what's known as do a definite integral to calculate the area from some interval from A to B, all right? So this big F is just the function such that if you take the derivative of it, you end up having the small f of x, which is the function that you want to find the area under the curve of, all right? So, an example, if you've never worked with integrals before, then makes this clear. So let's say I want to find the area under the curve, this f of x. So this is my function, okay? So if you graph this, and I want to find the area under the interval from 0 to 1. So if you graph this function from 0 to 1, it looks like this, all right? So it has some pretty high powers here. It's going to actually have a power of x to the 11. But from 0 to 1 is here. So the area is going to be all this area under the curve from y equals 0 up to here. So approximately, so if you look at this box from 0 to 1 and from height from 0 to 0.2, it looks like the maximum is here at about 0.2. So we know the area of that total box is just 0.2, so 1 times 0.2. So it looks like the area under the curve is about half of that. So as a rough estimate, I would expect half. It looks like a little bit less than half. So a little bit less than half of 0.2, like about 0.1 or a little bit less than 0.1 should be the area under the curve of this function from 0 to 1, all right? So let's see if we can find the antiderivative and use that to calculate the area exactly, right? So the easiest way to calculate the antiderivative for this expression is just to expand it out. So if you take the 1 minus x to the 4th and you square that, you get 1 minus 2x to the 4th, 2x to the 4th plus x to the 4th times x to the 4th, which is x to the 8th, right? And then you multiply x cubed times all those, so you get x cubed minus 2x to the 7th plus x to the 11th, okay? Now, like I said, the antiderivative is kind of the inverse. So instead of using the power rule, I need to use the inverse of that. So I want to raise the power by 1 and then divide by that raised power. So the antiderivative of x cubed is going to be 1 fourth x to the 4th, right? And the antiderivative of 2x to the 7th is going to be 1 eighth times x to the 8th, with that 2 still there. So you end up with 1 fourth. And this one is just x to the 12th divided by 12, right? And I leave it as an x. So take the derivative of this and you should get back this expression. Try using the power. You basically just need the power rule and the sum and subtraction and addition general property of derivatives there to do that, right? So that's the antiderivative. And notice I've got this little notation here. This is common from zero. So to so now if I want to use this to calculate the area, what's known as the definite integral for the integral from 0 to 1, I put 0 to 1 here. And then it's related to what we had done here by subtracting these two, right? So so basically, if you plug in 1 to the antiderivative and you subtract where you plug in 0, so you take the end of the interval, b, plug that in, and you subtract the beginning of the interval, the a. So in it, you just plug 1 in here. So you get 1/4 minus 1/4 plus 1/12. And then these are just all zeros. You get 0, 4, 0, 0, 0. So that's just 1/12, right? And 1/12 is 0.08333. So a little bit less than 0.1, like I said, right? So that, though, is the general procedure. So assuming that, so it's not always easy or even possible to find this antiderivative, like it's not always easy or possible to find the derivative of a function. But it's basically the same. So functions that you can find the derivative of, you can find the antiderivative of using the general properties or their inverses of derivatives, basically. Right? But then if you have this antiderivative expression, you can exactly find the area by plugging in the definite interval like that. And that gives you the area under the original function f of x. Right? Okay. So that's basically it. Oops. So we covered all these. So like I said, you know, we're not going to be doing a lot where you have to find, not any in this course, we have to you know the properties of derivatives and find, you know, exact solutions. So this is a course about numerical methods. But, you know, it is really useful to understand, you know, what we mean by derivative. It's really just the slope. It's the instantaneous slope. And then there's ways to find expressions for the instantaneous slope for many types of equations, right? But we're going to develop some numerical methods for finding the derivative of functions. And in that case, you don't need to be able to find the derivative symbolically. You can use a numerical method to find the derivative at any point on the equation. Likewise for integration. So again, many real functions are either very difficult, so like in machine learning, I might have functions with millions of variables. So good luck finding a symbolic solution for that. But it's relatively easy to apply a numerical method if I need to integrate a function over some interval. Okay, so that's it. Hopefully that gives you what you need to know for this course, and let you understand a little bit better what a derivative is, what an integral is, and I will see you next time.